If you've paid any attention to mainstream culture these last few years, you'd have noticed the wave of black anime fans that have outed themselves publicly. From famous musicians like Meg Thee Stallion,
like bad bitches can like anime too,
to famous actors who can't pronounce their favorite anime's name right.
Yes. It's a good question. Favorite anime is Naruto Shippuden.
That honestly just gets worse the more you hear it. Black person after black person has been choosing to love anime out loud and proud. But what caused this wave of newly proud black anime fans? And where does the interest in anime for black people come from? Why are they loving it? What's good, y'all? I'm Aaron, aka The Lost Homie, aka The Anime Anthology. Here to see if we can decipher this mystery.
You see me dead, do you? Well then. Go on.
Black people's love affair with anime is not a new trend. If you know anything about the history of anime in the United States and other countries that have large melanated populations, then you would have seen the love that the culture has been giving anime since day one. Starting at the beginning of the 21st century, two very creative minds would bridge the gap between Japanese animation and black culture. Renowned anime director Shinichiro Watanabe and genius comic strip writer Aaron Magruder created two separate titles that would become part of the cornerstone of the black experience within anime.
I am the stone that the builder refused. I am the visual, the inspiration that made ladies sing the blues. I'm the spark that makes your idea bright.
The Boondocks TV show by Aaron Magruder is a fusion of his love for anime and his poignant social commentary that made his comic strips famous. In a 2005 interview with the News Tribune, Magruder discussed why he wanted the Boondocks to be an anime show and the influence anime and manga had on the makings of the show. In an excerpt from the interview, he states, "I wanted it to be an anime show because I think as a medium, anime is, Japanese style of animation is, the most cinematic. And therefore, I think gives you the most flexibility in terms of doing humor for adults. And also, I wanted to do something very, very different from the style that Matt Groening basically set as a style for adult animation. And you know, and so I think The Simpsons is genius, but I want to do something very different from that. And so we did go in a very different direction, and it took a while for us to get it right." Aaron Magruder would go on in this interview to discuss how he wanted a show that was a different realm than other American adult animation. He wanted to mimic and or show his interpretation of how adult animation is handled in other countries such as Japan. This would become difficult for him because animators in the United States were not used to the process needed to create anime. Luckily, in season 2 of the Boondocks, the Japanese anime studio Madhouse would join in the mix in animating the show. As reported by the Anime News Network, creator Aaron Magruder commented on the change by saying, "We're creating a new system on the fly to get an authentic anime style but still have it be written with an American comedic sensibility." The success of a show like The Boondocks would be the starting point for many soon-to-be anime fans. For many who are already fans of anime, seeing its influences make it into a mainstream show that was representative of them made the appeal even greater for fans of the medium.
"Are you one of them? A Yagyu swordsman?"
"You're in the middle of something. Pardon me."
"Hey, are you one of those so-called badasses?"
"You've got the wrong guy. And don't bother waiting for the Yagyus. They're all gone."
"They're gone?
I killed all three."
"Better yet."
Samurai Champloo is a cultural marvel. An anime created by Shinichiro Watanabe expertly blended hip-hop styles with outstanding animation, pushing it firmly into the pantheon of black anime favorites. This show followed the success Watanabe had with his earlier iconic anime, Cowboy Bebop. Although Bebop in itself did an amazing job of bringing jazz to not only be the soundtrack, but the backbone of Bebop, Samurai Champloo could be considered the anime that truly exuded elements of black culture. However, that was no accident, but by design. In an interview with Eastern Kicks, Watanabe describes his early intentions with Samurai Champloo. "When I first come up with the idea of what I am going to create, quite often the music appears at the same time. So with Samurai Champloo, it wasn't that I had the story in mind and then added hip-hop to it. When I came up with the character of Mugen, I heard hip-hop at the same time, and I thought he was going to be a rapper samurai. This way of creating is what would make Samurai Champloo a lasting standout on the black anime landscape. To complete this blend of hip-hop style with Japanese animation, Watanabe would bring on Fat John, Force of Nature, Suichi, and the quintessential Nujabes. Nujabes' love for fusing old soul and jazz into modern hip-hop beats would cement his mark on the culture and push Samurai Champloo to new heights. The love for the culture seemed to seep out of the anime, infecting all who watched. This show never had any intention to bite the culture or claim it as its own, but to exemplify it and show its fluidity. This was not an anime that used hip-hop, but an anime that is hip-hop.
Now look who we got ourselves here.
Here you are, lemonade.
Drink that, boy.
Another one? On his tab?
Holy!
Here you are, lemonade. That's gonna cost you more than $2.50.
No discussion about the history of black culture and anime can be finished without mentioning Afro Samurai. Afro Samurai is the first anime series out of Japan boasting a black main character. Originally a Japanese manga series by Takashi Okazaki, it was serialized in avant-garde doujinshi manga magazine Nao High from November 1998 to September 2002. It was first animated in a miniseries by Gonzo in 2007 and given a film in 2009. Takashi Okazaki had a love for black culture that would push him into creating the manga that would later become an anime. In an interview with Cinema Factory, Okazaki would talk about the early days with creating Afro Samurai. I started writing Afro Samurai when I was a student, but I really liked hip hop and soul. And at that time, Soul Train was being rebroadcast, and that was really cool. In Japan, Afro was pretty laughing, but it wasn't. I was impressed that it was so cool. Touting Samuel L. Jackson in the titular role of Afro, this show was destined for success before it even aired on Spike TV. In an interview with LA Times, Jackson spoke about his love for the character and the closeness he felt for him. It's a wonderful adventure about a black samurai in a post-apocalyptic world that's a rich blend of the ancient and the new with the hip-hop beat. It's sexy, violent, and extremely cool. Afro is closer to me. I was an only child, and I'm used to being alone and being with my own thoughts. Jackson's own feelings about Afro would resonate with black watchers alike as they heap praise on his voice acting in the show itself. Afro Samurai was a series that every black anime fan wanted and more. A badass main character who fought against perilous struggles and achieved his main goal in the end. If Samurai Champloo and the Boondocks were the opening acts, this was the main event.
Clear, after just even meeting you for 2 minutes, that you love anime.
I'm super into it.
What would you say?
Real quick, I just want to ask you, what does anime mean to you?
Being yourself, bro, it's just another way of, you know, expressing of who you are. It gives you really good advice, you know, Naruto, you know.
It's been a really big impact on my life. Like, growing up, I really liked it.
It could be literally anybody. I would switch with Sailor Moon. She's so cool. I would just want to transform and be like.
In Atlanta, and like being surrounded by just rap culture, but seeing like the influence constantly from.
I actually wanted to talk to you about that.
Flooded with that,
specifically African American culture.
Yeah.
And a lot of the even pop culture in Japan. It's like there's a very big connecting thing that happens. My honest opinion about it is it has to do with relating in such a higher point. It's almost like it is inexplicable because it is the finer point of whatever that is.
Interesting.
You know,
ever since I was a kid, there was like a definite like force bringing the two together. And
culturally, there are a few experiences that most Black people share. These shared experiences bond us over immeasurable amounts of distance, creating what we call Black culture. There's just a certain defining factor in being Black that isn't like any other race on earth. In anime, many of us see our experiences played out in a way that makes us feel represented. Dragon Ball Z represents the journey of the Black man in America, RZA, founder of the Wu-Tang Clan. In his book, The Tao of Wu, RZA references the anime Dragon Ball Z as not only an inspiration, but how it relates to Black people as a whole. In the book, he goes on to say, "You see it more clearly as the story goes. You learn that Son Goku is part of an ancient race called the Saiyans, who come from a distant planet and were known as the fiercest warriors in the galaxy. So Son Goku has superpowers, but doesn't realize it. A head injury destroyed his memory, robbed his knowledge of self. Then one day, he gets stressed beyond his limits and hawks out to his alter ego, Super Saiyan, a nigga with dreadlocks. Get it?" Now, whether you agree with the RZA's description of Goku's story or not isn't the discussion here, but anime's parallels with how Black people feel about themselves and their history is clearly there. These feelings of similarity don't end with the story of Goku. As the new century began, it brought a new wave of anime as it became more accessible for Western audiences through Toonami and other American TV stations. And although Son Goku's story was still continuing, the younger Black audience hungered for newer characters that they could connect with. Here enters the big three: Naruto, Bleach, and One Piece. Three new shonen titles that would dominate in sales in Japan and the United States, bringing in bigger anime audiences than ever before, including Black ones. Black audiences across the United States would become enamored with the arrival of three new MCs inspired by the success of Dragon Ball Z, but still unique in their own distinct ways. For the sake of this video, I'm going to focus only on Naruto, but just know each title in its own way has been an inspiration for Black audiences everywhere. The story of Naruto is one that resonated greatly with Black audiences. His story touched on many of the issues that Black people had faced for decades and still face today. A boy who was discriminated against not only because of his lack of resources, but because he was Naruto. His ostracization would touch on many of the feelings that many young Black people felt at the turn of the century. Watching his journey towards social freedom and acceptance would become a pastime for the Black audiences that tuned in every week. As he grows, becoming stronger and gaining friends along the way, we feel hope in his journey. The path of a disparate youth discriminated against for factors outside of his control, ostracized by the people of his town, and forced to fight for acceptance is a story Black people are very familiar with. It should be no shock to anyone that the shonen genre as a whole would be something that resonates with Black people. Although there are shonen titles that deviate from the norm, I'm looking at you, Death Note and Future Diary. The tropes within shonen are ones of characters who are discriminated against for something bigger than just monetary troubles and rising above that. Beyond the tropes of shonen characters, anime tropes are littered with stories that resonate higher with their Black demographic. Impromptu parents, increasing strength against incredible odds, taking action against political violence, and so much more. The worlds within anime are unkind and deceitful. To Black people, they might as well mirror their realities in more ways than one. That's why when we see a character like Goku succeed against all odds, even though it shouldn't be possible in any way, shape, or form, we still cheer. Celebrating the highs and fighting through the lows is how we've learned to survive in a world that at times shows us that would rather us not exist. So even if Goku wins the next battle, or Eren dives into another group of unsuspecting bystanders, wait a minute, run that back. That man really woke up and just chose violence. Like, I haven't started watching this season yet, so this is my first time seeing this. Like, they had no clue what was going to happen, and he did not care at all. Wow. He did the right thing, though. Our heroes overcoming these overwhelming, overincumbent odds, what makes them our heroes.
You are now tuned in to the Black Anime Podcast.
The love for anime within the Black community has only grown as the years have progressed. From MC to MC and story to story, we have been able to connect with more characters on a broader scale than ever before. Outside of famous personalities professing their love for anime, Black creators in mass have rushed to the media, creating mountains of content to add to the broadening global image of anime. In 2019, Netflix would release their first anime on its platform to feature a Black main character. Cannon Busters by LaShawn Thomas, animated by Tokyo Animation Studio Satellite Incorporated, would be the next anime that Black audiences would latch onto. His love for anime started when he was a child watching the behind-the-scenes footage for the anime movie Akira. I'd never seen anyone animate anything like that. Compared to Hanna-Barbera, Looney Tunes, and American comic books I was consuming at the time, the way anime was drawn was just a higher level of detail and technique. It was just amazing. Cannon Busters would be a celebration for Black anime fans around the world, as we saw hope in a medium that we felt routinely ignored us. Thomas wouldn't be the only Black creator to think to bring his talents to Japan, as two Black background artists, Arthel and Darnell Isom, would move out to Japan to create the first Black-owned anime studio in Japan, The Art Shitaiju. This studio will go on to work on animes such as JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, Golden Wind, Seven Deadly Sins, Gintama, Tokyo Ghoul Ray, Record of Grand Crest War, Overlord, and One Piece. The Art Shitaiju even has released some original works such as Sturgill Simpson Presents Sound and Fury, a Netflix original anthology, and Indigo Ignited, an anime short. In an interview with GQ, Arthel references how Ghost in the Shell was really his big entry into anime. It's weird, because my story is a little different from other otaku. It really was just Ghost in the Shell. I did watch a few other anime after, but I was more into the art. I chose anime that I thought looked nice. I liked Last Exile, Escaflowne, Jinro, Ninja Scroll, and Pat Labor. The current Black anime revolution doesn't stop here. There are a huge crop of Black anime content creators popping up on YouTube, making podcasts, doing cosplay, and much more. RDC World has become famous for their relatable content and anime-themed videos, such as their Anime House series. Beyond the Bot is a podcast with a diverse set of hosts, including comedian Yodoye Travis, who hosted their episode on why they think anime is for Black people. I'd go check theirs out too. Honestly, it touches on a lot of stuff that I don't have the time for right here to discuss, so I would definitely go check that out if you're more interested on that kind of topic. Victoria L. Johnson hosts a podcast centered on Sailor Moon called the Sailor Moon Fan Club, in which she interviews Sailor Moon fans from writers to music artists such as Saweetie and Guapdad 4000. Noir Caesar is a Black-owned indie publishing company specializing in manga and anime. We have to mention the producers who have been influenced by Nujabes and Watanabe, such as Knowledge and I Love Brandon, who create beats that can be the soundtrack to your new favorite anime. There's also a large amount of Black mangakas and webtoon creators that have cropped up the past few years, creating amazing stories that are centered around the shonen genre and slice of life and other genres in which they've been influenced by through their avid anime watching and manga reading. This honestly isn't even the tip of the iceberg. Black creators have begun a revolution that harkens back to what our ancestors did when they were blocked from joining in with what the rest of the world was doing. Boss up and create our own shit. In many ways, we become the anime protagonists that we've come to love, revere, and praise. And hopefully, like One Piece and Case Closed, there's no end in sight for the journeys we will embark on. I hope I answered the question. I hope I did. You know, one time, instead of saying, you know, Gurren Lagann, I said Gurren Lagann, like, on live, on pod. That's crazy. That's wild. Am I not a real anime fan now? Nah.